2 years ago, I stood right here and told you that the multi-billion dollar vertical farming industry was an epic failure. But the world's most famous vacuum company just proved us wrong. Or did they? Since that video, the industry has absolutely been decimated. Plenty, after raising billions of dollars in investment, have gone bankrupt. Bowery Farming, Aero Farms, App Harvest, all of them gone or reorganized. Investment in the sector has fallen by over 90%. And this is a story of how the guys who completely reinvented the humble vacuum cleaner might have just done the same thing for vertical farming. It's also a story of how, by digging through the numbers, we found a secret that changes everything. Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Delete Me. So, how did a vacuum cleaner company succeed where hundreds of specialized startups backed by billions of dollars fail? Well, by identifying the exact engineering sins that I talked about in that previous video, we'll link above, and solving them one by one. The biggest problem was always the astronomical energy cost. Vertical farms were basically giant windowless warehouses that had to replicate the power of the sun 24/7 using thousands of high-powered LEDs. It was incredibly expensive, and it couldn't compete with open field or greenhouse farming, which gets all of its light for free. Dyson's solution is deceptively simple. Use as much sunlight as possible. Instead of a black box, they built a massive 26-acre glass house. But here's the genius part. Inside, they have these enormous rotating rigs. We're talking almost 80 feet long and 18 feet tall that look like Ferris wheels for plants. These rigs slowly turn, ensuring every single strawberry plant gets the maximum possible amount of natural free sunlight throughout the day. LEDs are only used to supplement light on cloudy days and in the shorter winter months, not as a primary source. This single change slashes their energy demand for lighting, which accounts for over half the power usage in a traditional vertical farm. The next fatal flaw was a broken business model. Vertical farm startups were burning cash trying to compete with dirt cheap field-grown lettuce. They were growing a low-value crop with a high-cost method. Dyson flipped the script. They targeted a premium high-value crop, strawberries. 250 grams of Dyson Farm strawberries sell today for €4.50, which is around $11 per pound. Lettuce in the UK, on the other hand, costs 40 cents per 100 grams or $2.40 per pound, under a quarter of the value. Without automation, vertical farms are very labor intensive. I found that a 1,000 square meter vertical lettuce farm requires about 16,000 to 20,000 man hours per year to operate. That's 34 to 42 full-time workers per acre. For instance, Plenty, the famous $1 billion California-based vertical farm company that filed for bankruptcy in 2024, employed 80 full-time workers for its 100,000 square foot vertical farm in Compton, which works out to about 35 workers per acre. Dyson used its experience in technology and manufacturing to automate most of the farming operations, requiring only 83 workers for its entire 26-acre glass house. That's only 3 to 4 workers per acre, one-tenth of what the other vertical farms employed. Now, I know there are some other more advanced vertical farms that also rely heavily on automation and reduce worker operational needs, but we're comparing Dyson here to the spectacular failures that we covered in our previous video. It's easy for diseases to spread in enclosed environments. Just think back to COVID to see what I mean. This is a major risk for both traditional greenhouses and vertical farms. For example, in May 2023, a leaf-eating pathogen called Phytophthora infected Bowery Farms and quickly spread, killing a large swath of its crops and eventually bringing down the $2.3 billion company. In contrast, Dyson controls this risk with advanced automation and pest control. Robots handle strawberry picking, UV systems kill mold, and the system even releases live insects in precise locations to control aphids and other pests. This reduces manual labor and proactively manages disease risks inherent in any controlled environment. I just knew we had to make this video because Dyson is a company I love and trust. And trust is a rare commodity these days online, and why I've been a member of Delete Me, our sponsor this week, for nearly 3 years. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that removes your personal information that's being sold online. It is completely legal for data brokers to collect your name, phone number, and address and sell to anyone with a credit card. But Delete Me has your back. They continuously remove your data online using their own tech and don't outsource to third parties. And it's not just one time. Delete Me constantly monitors the web and removes your data from hundreds of data brokers. I just got my 11th quarterly report. Delete Me scanned over 1,900 listings, and thanks to their constant diligence, my data didn't appear anywhere in this last quarter. Amazing progress from the early reports that I got when I first joined. And Delete Me has family plans to protect your entire family's personal data. We all have a lot on our minds, so join Delete Me and let them take care of that for you, so you have one less thing to worry about. Get started today and save 20% on all plans using my code Ricky. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Delete Me and you. Now back to the show. The farm also relies on custom-made in-house sensor packs to control humidity, temperature, and CO2 levels. And they even have a special Apogee PAR sensor which can measure the amount of light in a specific wavelength for crops like strawberries and supplement it with LED lighting just to provide the optimal amount of light needed and save on cost. So that's a quick rundown on how Dyson overcame vertical farming's key challenges. But they didn't stop there, because the strawberry farm is a part of a larger system. I'll tell you right now, that's one of the biggest strengths that really makes this whole thing work. But it's also where things became a little more misleading, and one of the reasons why I don't think that Dyson fully solved vertical farming. But we'll get back to that here in a minute. Dyson's hybrid vertical farm is part of a true circular economic system. Now, this next part is vital. Right next to the greenhouse, they built an anaerobic digester. It's basically a giant mechanical stomach. They feed it biomass from Dyson's other traditional farming operations, and it digests it to produce biogas. That biogas powers a turbine that generates all the electricity for the farm, and then some. So the entire automated robotic vertical farm doesn't spend a dime on energy. It's all generated in-house. What's even more clever is that the waste heat from the turbine is piped directly into the greenhouse to keep the strawberries warm. This directly eliminates about 10% of the energy a typical greenhouse or vertical farm consumes. And the CO2 from the exhaust? Also piped into the greenhouse where the plants breathe it and turn it into fresh strawberries and other biomass. It's pretty much a carbon capture system from the biogas power plant. Remember, the CO2 we talk about as a bad thing, but it is literally plant food. And in this particular scenario, that synergy is insanely brilliant. Now, rainwater is collected from the roof for irrigation, which is pretty standard, and the end result is a nearly perfectly closed loop system where every waste stream becomes a valuable input. Okay, so a billionaire figured out how to grow expensive strawberries in a fancy greenhouse. Why should we care? Well, because this isn't just about fruit. It's a potential blueprint for a more resilient and sustainable food system. Think about it. The U.S. gets a huge portion of its fresh fruits and vegetables from places like California and Mexico. When a drought hits California or a trade issue complicates imports, prices for everyone go up and shelves can go empty. The promise of a system like Dyson's is local food security. It's the ability to grow produce year-round right outside of major cities using a fraction of the land with higher yields and less water. Dyson Farms produces 48 tons of strawberries per acre. The average U.S. farm? Just 23 tons. Even California, with its perfect climate, only gets 31 tons. Dyson is producing over 50% more than the best farms in the world, and 250% more than local British farms, for example. Farms that Dyson is competing with directly. And they're doing this, at least this first iteration, in the notoriously cloudy and gray UK. That is a game changer. To understand how this happened, we have to understand Sir James Dyson. Most people probably know him for the bagless cyclone vacuum that made him the fifth richest person in the UK. But at his core, he's a relentless hands-on engineer. And about a decade ago, he started buying land. A lot of land. Today, Dyson Farming owns 36,000 acres of prime English farmland. The average farm in the UK is just over 200 acres. Dyson's operation is the size of 177 of those farms stitched together, making him the single largest and most technologically advanced farming business in the country. And this is the most critical point. Dyson Farming isn't a startup. It wasn't funded by Silicon Valley venture capitalists demanding hockey stick growth and a quick exit. It's a long-term, privately funded project by an engineer who spent 15 years and over 5,000 prototypes perfecting his first vacuum. He's applied the same slow, methodical, iterative approach to agriculture. The vertical farm wasn't a wild bet. It was a logical next step for an already massive, profitable, and high-tech farming operation that turned over 42.2 million euros in profit last year. Dyson is treating farming like manufacturing, focusing on precision, efficiency, and quality control. This foundation of patient capital and deep agricultural experience is what allowed him to build a system designed to work for decades, not just to look good in a pitch deck. Okay, so on the surface, it looks like a genius move, a perfect closed-loop system that finally makes vertical farming profitable. By pure logic, this should spend less energy and be cheaper to run, and the yields are great. But I'm an engineer and I wanted to see the numbers because, well, sometimes the devil is in the details. And when I started digging into these numbers, I found something that was completely off. Something that changes this entire story. Here's what happened. I wanted to compare the actual energy consumption of Dyson's strawberry glasshouse with the failed billion-dollar vertical farms to see just how big the difference really was. And needless to say, those numbers aren't readily available, so I had to do some calculations. Since the glasshouse is a closed system that pulls all of its energy from the adjacent biogas turbine, and since Dyson publicly states that the system produces enough electricity to power 10,000 UK homes, I figured I could probably work my way backward. But when I did the estimates, the numbers didn't add up, not by a long shot. Here's the breakdown. The average UK household uses about 2,700 kilowatt hours of electricity per year. Those are the official numbers. So powering 10,000 homes would mean Dyson Systems produces 27 million kilowatt hours or 27 gigawatt hours annually. Now, there's no reason to think that every single kilowatt hour of energy produced was actually consumed. They might have sent it back to the grid. But how could we possibly find that out? Well, it turns out it was actually pretty easy. Looking through their financial records for 2024, which, unlike in the US, private companies in the UK are legally required to make public, the record details how much energy Dyson sold to the UK grid. $10.87 million worth of energy in 2023 and $9.37 million worth in 2024. Based on the average wholesale electricity prices in the UK for 2023 and 2024, the revenue means that they exported 100 to 114 gigawatt hours per year, not 27. This isn't exactly a rounding error. I dug deep to see if there was a flaw in the calculations, but it's all pretty straightforward. And this is really strange. I mean, think about it. The amount of electricity Dyson actually sold to the grid was over four times higher than the total amount they claim their system can even produce. Why would a company do that? Why would you downplay just how much power you could produce? I think I might have the answer, and we will get to that here in a minute. Just for now, know that that 10,000 UK homes figure is totally off, and we can't use it to calculate the glass house's energy consumption. So what do? Well, I decided to make an educated guess. Dyson says the glass houses use a small fraction of the power the anaerobic digesters produce. If we put that fraction at, let's say, 10%, around 1.14 gigawatt hours, it would mean that Dyson Vertical Farms consumes about 9 kilowatt hours per kilogram of strawberries. Is that high? Low? Turns out, this number actually makes a lot of sense. A 2021 global report on controlled environment agriculture found that normal greenhouses consume an average of 5.4 kilowatt hours per kilogram of produce. So when you factor in that Dyson doesn't have to run supplemental LED lighting quite as much, it gets heat for free from the biogas ingester, this kind of makes sense, and I'd probably put the consumption around 7 to 15 kilowatt hours per kilogram. Now this part is staggering. Vertical farms of the past average 38.8 kilowatt hours per kilogram for simple leafy greens like lettuce. For a more energy intensive fruiting crop with a longer crop cycle like strawberries, the consumption would have easily been 2 to 3 times higher, likely in the range of 75 to over 100 kilowatt hours per kilogram. Dyson's hybrid system uses a tenth of that energy, a 90% reduction in energy use. And that's pretty amazing. So clearly, their hybrid approach and all the other innovations that they've employed here make a ton of sense. But let's go back to that previous question. Why would you downplay how much energy you can produce? Companies don't usually do that. In fact, private companies usually do the opposite, bloating about their numbers. And then I started thinking about a video we did recently about a concept in desalination where a company was going to produce energy and sell that to offset the cost to bring the cost for the desalinated water in line with water prices today. And I think that kind of gets to the heart of this. There was a quote I read in a specialized farming publication from an engineer working at Dyson who said that half the profits from the integrated vertical farm come not from the berries, but from the sale of electricity generated by the biogas plants. That would mean that in a way, the strawberries are a byproduct of this entire process. And suddenly things start to make a lot more sense. Dyson strawberries are already sold in the UK at a premium price, more than double that of supermarket strawberries, because they're more expensive to grow. Despite the extra yield, they still consume a lot more energy than when growing in a greenhouse, which has always been the bane of vertical farming. Dyson's business model covers part of the cost by using the electricity produced by the anaerobic digesters. Yet, they still have to sell the strawberries at twice the price to make any real profit. So the reality is, electricity generation is equally responsible for the profitability of the system as is the crops that they actually produce. Or put another way, without the energy subsidy, the strawberries would be way too expensive to sell. But is that a bad thing? And I think the answer is absolutely not, because the biogas reactor would probably be leaking methane out naturally from anaerobic processes in nature by itself for no value. Instead, we're benefiting from that and using that energy. And two, the carbon dioxide that is emitted from the process doesn't just go into the atmosphere. It gets fed into these glass houses where they go into creating the makeup of the plants themselves. And at the end of the day, we get electricity and crops. One of the things that I've always mentioned is there are technologies that don't make commercial viable economic sense today that we still need to invest in. Desalination comes to mind, and maybe vertical farming is the second. So even though they don't make financial sense today, a cheap strawberry grown in a natural field is less expensive, true. But what happens if a volcano erupts and we're in a four-year nuclear winter and we'd have no sunlight for 4 years? What happens to mankind, right? Vertical farms could potentially still work with a nuclear reactor and, you know, something else and artificial lighting. These are things that just matter. Desalination is kind of the same way. So I got to say, pretty genius. I think Dyson's got something here. And I think this model of producing energy is actually something all farmers could benefit from. Putting solar panel arrays along fields, agro-photovoltaic farming, where you mix in crops and yields along with solar panels. These are things that can offset the incredibly difficult economics of farming and give farmers more stability. But what do you think? What do you think about the story and this approach to vertical farming? Sound off in the comments below. And until next week, check out this video that we think you'll love. I'm Ricky Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.